Well, friends, once again, welcome to our service of worship here on this Sunday, the 12th of July. Christ Church, Castle Dawson, we're in the Parish Hall again this Sunday, and we just want to say a word of welcome. Before our service begins, just a few very short announcements, and those announcements just are simply to say thank you. Thank you to you, our parishioners. Thank you for, first of all, tuning in to our services week by week. And thank you for supporting our church financially. Many of you have been dropping in your church envelopes through the rectory letterbox, and I'm very grateful for that. And others have been collecting through the week as we deliver DVDs, etc. So once again, my thanks to everyone who's been supporting us. Of course, there's also the standing order donations that have been made and transfers and the like. Thank you. Please continue to, at this holiday time now, we're a lot of people will be maybe heading up to the caravans and heading off maybe even to sunnier climes if you're brave enough. Just please keep safe and keep well, and remember the whole social distancing thing. And remember just that others around you may not just be as aware or as in tune, and just bear with them on that too. So thank you for joining us today. I'm going to be helped at our service by Alana, who's going to bring us our slot talk for our children. Carla and Marissa are going to read for us. And I'm really grateful to everyone who has contributed over these weeks and who will contribute in the weeks to come for helping us and sharing and being part of the whole ministry team here at Christ Church. So thank you once again, one and all. So as we begin our service, we turn again to God's word, and there will be some scripture verses, maybe 10 scripture verses, and I pray that these verses will be a blessing to you. As we come to worship, I just want to read this opening prayer, and then we're going to enter into a time of worship as we sing the hymn complete. Father God, give us a sense of your presence as we gather now to worship you. Grant us gratitude as we remember your goodness, penitence as we remember our sins. But Lord, also give us joy as we remember your forgiveness and your love, and enable us to lift up our hearts in humble prayer and fervent praise through the one who makes us complete, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Thank you.
sacrifice my open heart. I offer up my life, I look to you, Lord. Your love that never ends restores me again. So I lift my eyes to you, Lord. In your strength will I break through, Lord. Touch me now, let your love fall down on me. I know your love dispels all my fears. Through the storm I will hold on, Lord, and by faith I will walk on, Lord. Then I'll see beyond my Calvary that day, and I will be complete.
Yeah.
are complete in him, and through him we have the victory. And the theme of our service today is victory. We're going to hear a reading read for us, and in this reading it's about one of the greatest victories that is recorded in scripture, certainly in the Old Testament anyhow. We'll all know this story, and we've just got to the part in this story from 1 Samuel chapter 17, and we're going to read from verse 41 to 51, and Marissa's going to do that for us, but this is just at the stage whenever the young shepherd boy David is just about to be confronted by the giant Goliath. So over to Marissa.
So the Philistine came and began drawing near to David, and the man who bore the shield went before him. And when the Philistine looked about and saw David, he disdained him, for he was only a youth, ruddy and good-looking. So the Philistine said to David, "Am I a dog that you come to me with sticks?" And the Philistine cursed David by his gods. And the Philistine said to David, "Come to me, and I will give your flesh to the birds of the air and the beasts of the field." Then David said to the Philistine, "You come to me with a sword, with a spear, and with a javelin. But I come to you in the name of the Lord of hosts, the God of the armies of Israel, whom you have defied. This day the Lord will deliver you into my hand, and I will strike you and take your head from you. And this day I will give the carcasses of the camp of the Philistines to the birds of the air and the wild beasts of the earth, that all the earth may know that there is a God in Israel. Then all this assembly shall know that the Lord does not save with sword and spear, for the battle is the Lord's, and he will give you into our hands." So it was, when the Philistine arose and came and drew near to meet David, that David hurried and ran towards the army to meet the Philistine. Then David put his hand in his bag and took out a stone, and he slung it and struck the Philistine in his forehead, so that the stone sank into his forehead and he fell on his face to the earth. So David prevailed over the Philistine with a sling and a stone, and struck the Philistine and killed him, but there was no sword in the hand of David. Therefore David ran and stood over the Philistine, took his sword and drew it out of his sheath, and killed him, and cut off his head with it. And when the Philistines saw that their champion was dead, they fled. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
This is the story of David and Goliath. David was just an ordinary boy. There was nothing extraordinary about him. He was a simple shepherd who lived a very basic life. Until one day, everything changed. On this day, he was delivering food to his brothers on the front line of battle. While he was there, Goliath appeared on the battlefield. Goliath was a giant who was more than 9 feet tall. David noticed Goliath as he shouted for a man to come and fight him. David stepped forward. Because David was a young shepherd boy, he was too weak to wear the heavy armour or carry a sword. So instead, David picked up 5 smooth stones. David threw one stone and knocked Goliath out. David won victory over Goliath. So boys and girls, I'd just like to say a big thank you to Jack, who played the role of David in the story of David and Goliath. But boys and girls, why did I tell you that story today? So the story of David and Goliath features a very tall giant who was over 9 feet tall. But we won't face these kinds of giants in our lives. We face a different kind of giant in our daily lives. So when I say the word giant, I'm really talking about trials and troubles that we face that can be really hard to get past or solve. We face giants in our lives, such as being scared of the dark, facing a really tricky maths homework, or just feeling lonely when no one else is around. But how do we overcome these giants that want to defeat us every single day? The 5 stones that David put in his tiny little pouch as he went to face Goliath can help us discover how we overcome the giants in our lives. So just let me tell you. The first stone represents courage. David was not afraid to face his enemy, the big giant Goliath. But rather, instead, he said to Saul, "Do not worry about a thing. I will go and fight this Philistine." So we should have the courage in our life to stand up to our fears and worries. Often this can be really hard to do, and we shy away or give up on things in our life that challenge us. But that is not the attitude we should take, and instead we should take David's approach and walk every day with courage to face our giants. The second stone represents confidence. As a shepherd, David often had to protect the sheep from wild animals. This gave him the confidence he needed to face the giant. "The Lord who saved me from the claws of the lion and the bear will save me from this Philistine." Like David, you can have the confidence that the Lord will help you overcome the problems that you face every single day. The third stone represents preparation. David didn't go to face the giant unprepared. He went down to the stream and picked out 5 smooth stones and put them in his little shepherd's bag. Then, armed with his shepherd's staff and a sling, he started out to fight Goliath. It is important for you to do everything possible to be certain you are prepared to face the challenges which meet you in your daily life. The fourth stone represents trust. David knew that he could not defeat this giant alone. When Goliath shouted at David and was ready to kill him, David said, "You come to me with a sword and spear, but I come to you in the name of the Lord God Almighty." David trusted God to help him win his battle and gain victory over the giant. So boys and girls, when you face problems in your life, when you face a giant, put your trust in God and not in your own ability, and you will succeed. The fifth stone represents victory. David said, "It is God's battle, not ours." That is why David was able to win victory over the giant with only a stone and a sling. When you turn your battles over to God, you will gain victory over the giants in your life. So boys and girls, mums and dads, grannies and grandas, whenever you feel lonely, sad, or annoyed, just remember the story of David and Goliath and how that if we put our trust in God, he will never leave us and always be by our side. Always remember the 5 little pebbles: courage, confidence, preparation, trust, and victory. The Lord is greater than the giants you face. 1 John chapter 4, verse 4.
My thanks to both Marissa for her reading and for Alana and Jack as well for sharing that great message about those 5 little stones. The last one of which was the stone, of course, of victory. And our next hymn speaks about that, and it's called "Jesus, We Celebrate Your Victory."
Jesus, we celebrate the victory. Jesus, we revel in your love. Jesus, we rejoice, you set us free. Jesus, your death has brought us life. It was for
Christ has set us free, no longer to be subject to the yoke of slavery. So we're rejoicing in God's victory, our hearts responding to His love. Jesus, we celebrate your victory. Jesus, we revel in your love. Jesus, we rejoice you set us free. Jesus, your death has brought us life. Your Spirit in us releases us from fear. The way to Him is open, with boldness we draw near. And in His presence, our problems disappear. Our hearts responding to His love. Jesus, we celebrate your victory. Jesus, we revel in your love. Jesus, we rejoice you set us free. Jesus, your death has brought us life. Jesus, we celebrate your victory. Jesus, we revel in your love. Jesus, we rejoice you set us free. Jesus, your death has brought us life. Jesus, your death has brought us life. I said, Jesus, your death has brought us life.
Now we're going to have our second reading, and Carla is going to bring us that reading from 1 Corinthians chapter 15.
Listen to this secret truth. We shall not all die, but when the last trumpet sounds, we shall be changed in an instant, as quickly as the blinking of an eye. For when the trumpet sounds, the dead will be raised, never to die again, and we shall all be changed. For what is mortal must be changed into what is immortal. What will die must be changed into what cannot die. So when this takes place and the mortal has been changed into the immortal, then the scriptures will come true. Death is destroyed. Victory is complete. Where death is your victory? Where death is your power to hurt? Death gets its power to hurt from sin, and sin gets its power from the law. But thanks be to God who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ.
Still a mystery.
day. I fall on my knees, 'cause your grace still amazes me. Your grace still amazes me.
Your grace still amazes me. And it's that grace, of course, that gives us the victory. Friends, this is the 12th of July. On this particular day, this Sabbath day, many in our society regard this day as a day to commemorate a past historical event. In fact, it's an especially important historical event. An event that has shaped our nation and many other nations as well. It has shaped us in the way that we think, the way that we act, and it has done so for generations. It's a day when we declare victory. It's a day when we shout, "The battle has been won." It's a day to remember. It's a day to sing. It's a day to make music. It's a day to give thanks, and it's a day to celebrate. Yes, it is Sunday. The day when worshippers gather to give thanks and celebrate. the day whenever we celebrate the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. Because, friends, we are a resurrection people. We know that Jesus went to the cross and that he died, but he won us an amazing victory, not only over sin on the cross, but over death itself, when on that first Easter morning, he rose again. The battle was won. The king reigns supreme. The future is secure. The victory is his. And of course, we're talking about Jesus. And we're going to talk about that whole concept of victory. I wonder, have you ever been victorious in any area of your life? We can all look at being victorious in different ways. Often the idea of victory is about overcoming the odds, beating others to the top spot, being the best, being the quickest, being the strongest, being the one who endures. For example, I remember in 1988 obtaining the Player of the Year award from the football team that I played for. So, voted for by the other players. What a victory that was. Maybe not. But sometimes we can really focus in on the victories we've won, whether it be a sporting victory, or maybe we've been victorious in terms of our exam results. Or maybe we've got the promotion that we wanted, and there were 10 others in for it, but you got it. Maybe we were victorious in that bowls tournament where we had entered. Maybe your victory came from simply passing your driving test. Perhaps your victory came from just making it through school, like me. The Bible is full of examples of God miraculously bringing victory out of impending defeat. In our first reading today, we heard of one of those scriptures, of one of the greatest and most unexpected victories that took place. Such a well-known story, and Alana has shared about it, but I'm just going to touch on it a little bit more, and then we'll think about the second reading. We've all heard that story of David and Goliath in Sunday school. It's a classic. How the odds were overturned. What was perceived as the weak overcoming the strong. The impossible happening and the mighty falling. David was just a shepherd boy, a young teenager. And he was visiting his brothers who were fighting on the front line against the Philistines. He was bringing them some food. His father had sent him with food. He'd left the food, but he wanted to go up and see what was happening at the front line. Maybe say hello to the brothers and try to encourage them. Of course, when he was there, he hears the Philistine giant Goliath shouting, making fun of the Israelites, making fun of God's chosen people. Of course, David couldn't tolerate those insulting remarks that Goliath was making. The mockery, and how he even mocked King Saul. David was flabbergasted. He was probably flabbergasted at a number of things. He was probably flabbergasted at Saul, because Saul and his whole army seemed to be afraid. There was little courage being shown. Everyone was afraid of the giant. So David goes to Saul and he says, I'll take him on. I'll take on the giant. And as we know, the rest is history. God, through David, showed us how to trust, to face our giants, to overcome fear, and to stand up for what is right and what is God-honoring. God was with David. So today, I don't want to talk only about the giants that we may face in this life. Alana's covered that. Don't want to talk about the fears that we may have or even the weakness we may feel when we're called to stand up for the Lord. I want us to focus on the battle and the victory. And our reason for celebrating and commemorating the greatest victory of all. I'm not talking about David overcoming Goliath. It's another victory. A world-changing victory. A life-changing victory. David's victory showed God's amazing ability to equip the weak, to shame and defeat the strong. But David's victory, in fact, all of David's victories, because throughout his life he had many, many triumphs, but all of them fade into the background. They fade into insignificance when compared to the event that Paul makes reference to in his letter to the Corinthians. And this is the same truth that we commemorate and we celebrate today. Let's hear what Paul says, 1 Corinthians 15 and 54. He says, "So when this takes place and the mortal has been changed into the immortal, then the scriptures will come true. Death is defeated, victory is complete." Where death is your victory? Where death is your sting or your power to hurt? But thanks be to God who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. What is this victory? The victory Jesus has won for us. Victory over sin and victory over death. I don't know about you, but I often feel as weak as water in my Christian life when faced with a giant called sin. Each day I enter into a battle, and even though I know that the Lord is there to help me, and he does, I sometimes attempt to fight these battles on my own strength. But I soon realize that I'm doomed to fail, and I risk losing that battle. There are days when I feel useless, when I feel weak, when I feel unworthy to even think of myself as a Christian, to bear Christ's name. I'm sometimes ashamed that I have fallen on my Christian walk. But then I recall the Word of God, and in particular the fact that God knows that I can't win any victory over sin on my own. Just like David couldn't win or be victorious over the giant on his own. He needed God to empower him. I need God to empower me. I need Christ in my life. And I need to give him full authority in all things. Because it's only through him that my shame is covered and my shame is dealt with. And my sin is washed away completely. You see, my sin and your sin have already been dealt with by Jesus. He took our sin and he took our shame on his shoulders on the cross so that we could know the victory of redemption that has been won for us, so that we can have the assurance of salvation, our sins forgiven by the grace of God. However, isn't it so true that the evil one does not want us to believe that Jesus' victory can impact on us? Satan wants to keep us down. He wants to weaken our faith. He wants to draw us away from God. And he wants to deliver us to a lost eternity. You know, friends, there's a cosmic battle going on. There's a real battle taking place for souls. And you and I are right smack bang in the middle of it. Friends, those who have put their trust in the crucified and risen Lord Jesus can be assured of victory. And here's the main reason for us to celebrate today, and every Sunday, in fact, every day. Jesus not only offers us victory over sin, but he has also won for us the ultimate victory, victory over death. So as a resurrection people, we acknowledge Jesus' resurrection on that first Easter morning, the glorious victory that also brings us the certainty of eternal life. Paul says in Philippians 3, he says, "We, however, are citizens of heaven. We eagerly await for our Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ, to come from heaven. He will change our mortal bodies and make them like his own glorious body, using the power by which he is able to bring all things under his rule." Effectively giving us complete victory over our enemy, Satan. But folks, there is, of course, one requirement if we are going to obtain this victory. Can victory be achieved unless we're prepared to take up the challenge? David said to Saul, "Your Majesty, this Philistine shouldn't turn us into cowards. I will go and fight him myself. I will take up the challenge." Now, perhaps you're watching this today and you want assurance of your eternal destiny. Maybe you know what is needed for you to know the victory that Jesus has won for you. But there's something holding you back. There are giants standing there in front of you. And these giants are things like doubt, lack of faith. Maybe your giant is pressure from someone else or from others. Maybe your giant is some perceived embarrassment. Maybe you just don't think you're good enough. Maybe you don't think you could win this battle over sin. Friend, you've no need to worry about any of those things. You've just got to let Jesus deal with the giants. He'll deal with doubt, and he'll give you assurance. He'll increase your faith if you ask him. He will change your life. Embarrassment? How embarrassed will you be when you stand before the judgment seat of God and you're asked to give an account of your life? And you're asked to reflect on the opportunities you had to know this great salvation that Jesus offered. How embarrassed will you be when the Lord asks you, "Why did you not take up the challenge?" And as for not being good enough to be a Christian, you're 100% right, you're not. None of us are, but God's grace is enough. So friend, if you want to know victory today, you need to know the one who has won the victory for us. Jesus, the champion of the world, the Redeemer, the Savior, the Healer, the Lord, the King, the Mighty One, the Living One, the Son of God, the Son of Man, the Victorious One. And through offering your life to him today, you can know this victory. You can know the victory he's won for you. If you remember nothing else about this talk today, just remember these few words. You can't have the victory without knowing the victor. That's Jesus. Here's what Peter said in Acts chapter 4. And there is salvation in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven given among men by which we must be saved. He's speaking of Jesus. You know, being a faithful churchgoer won't do it. Being a decent person and doing some good things, that won't do it. Being affiliated to this or that religious organization and following some list of rules, that won't do it. Listen to what Article 18 of the 39 articles contained in our prayer books has to say. It says, they also are to be accursed that presume to say that every man shall be saved by a law or sect which he professeth, so that he be diligent to frame his life according to that law and the light of nature. For Holy Scripture doth set out unto us only the name of Jesus Christ, whereby men must be saved. Friends, that article just is backed up by what Peter had to say in that previous reading that I read from Acts 4 and verse 12. In Revelation chapter 1 and 18, Jesus says, I am the living one. I was dead, but now I am alive forever. And I have authority over death and the world of the dead. Jesus was dead. He became alive. He won the victory for you and for me. The challenge is there. Christ gives us the victory. He's won it for us all. And all we have to do is reach out and take hold of it and allow him to sort all the giants that we face. Let's pray. Heavenly Father and loving God, we give you thanks for Jesus and the victory that he has won for us. Lord, we turn to him now. We ask him to speak again into our lives and into our hearts. And Lord, help us respond to your call to follow you. And Lord, I pray for anyone watching today who doesn't know you yet as Lord and Savior of their lives, who hasn't yet got the guarantee of that victory, that one day our mortal body will be turned into an immortal and perfect body because of what Jesus has done. So Lord, we thank you again for your goodness. And we pray that you would open our hearts to receive you and that we too would know such great victory when you come or call. For it is in Jesus' name we ask it. Amen. Friends, I want to invite you to join with me in reading the creedal statement that will appear on your screen. We believe in God the Father, by whose great mercy we have been born again to a living hope, through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. We believe in God the Son, who died for our sin, and rose again for our justification, the one through whom we have the victory. We believe in God the Holy Spirit, who bears witness with our spirit that we are the children of God. We believe in one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Friends, we're now going to worship God again. This is a wonderful piece. It talks about the victory of Jesus. It's called Living Hope.
Between us, how high the mountain I could not climb. In desperation, I turned.
turned to heaven and spoke your name into the night. Then through the darkness, your loving kindness tore through the shadows of my soul. The work is finished, the end is written. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Who could imagine so great a mercy? What heart could fathom such boundless grace? The God of cross has spoken, I am forgiven. The King of Kings calls me his own. Beautiful Savior, I'm yours forever. Jesus Christ, my
Jesus, yours is the victory. We're going to turn to the victorious Jesus now in prayer as we pray our prayers in his name. Heavenly Father, we bring before you our nation. Lord, you have created all mankind. You have divided us up into nations. Very often, Lord, we're in the frame of mind to put other nations down and to think that our nation is better than any other. Lord, and there's one thing this time of coronavirus has taught us. It's that we really are all in the same boat. We are all in need of your healing. We're all in need of your mercy. We're all in need of your righteous hand upon us. Lord, I pray for the leaders of our nations today, with all the challenging and difficult decisions that they have to make. Lord, bless our leaders here in Stormont. Guide and direct them and grant them wisdom. Lord, the leaders of the other jurisdictions in the United Kingdom, as well as the leaders across the border in the Republic. Lord, may they all work together with other nations of the world, work together for the betterment of everyone. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, we pray for your church. Lord, our own church is still not meeting as a fellowship yet. We are grateful, Lord, that we have the facility to meet online. But yet we pray, Lord, that you would guide and direct the leaders of our church here, that you would guide us to know when is the right time for us to reopen our church doors again. Lord, we remember our brothers and sisters in the other denominations here locally, and indeed right across our nation. Lord, be with our bishop, Bishop Andrew. Lord, as he seeks to continue to support us and to guide us and to help us in the way forward, as to know what we should and what we shouldn't do and when we should and shouldn't do it. Lord, bless your church and renew us by your Holy Spirit. Lord, today we want to remember the weak in our society. We pray for those who are in any need, especially for those known to us. We pray for those who are under the threat of unemployment. We pray for those who already have lost their jobs and are finding it difficult to make ends meet. We pray for the sick in body or in mind, that through your healing power they may be made whole. We pray for those who are disabled. We pray for those who are recovering from coronavirus. Lord, we pray that you would give them courage, that you would give them faith and strength. Lord, today we also remember the elderly, the infirm. We pray that you would renew them. We particularly think of those known to us who are in care homes, loved ones who we have not been able to visit for many, many weeks. Lord, we pray for those who have asked for our prayers, especially at this difficult time because of illness. You remember young Ozzy. We remember Alistair. We pray for Jonty and for Ronnie. Father, we bring before you the needs of those whose lives are overshadowed by suffering. And we pray, Lord, that you would bring healing in the name of Jesus. And finally, Lord, we want to remember those who grieve today, those who have lost loved ones as a result of coronavirus. Lord, on just listening to the news earlier yesterday, hearing that over 800 people in our small province have died as a result of coronavirus. Lord, please be with their family members. Be with also, Lord, those who are undergoing treatment for cancer. those who are receiving treatment for kidney failure, those who are on dialysis, those who are receiving treatment for heart failure, those who are riddled with infections. Lord, there's a list so long of all the diseases and ailments that people are suffering from. We pray, Lord, in the name of Jesus, that you would lift up their hearts, that you would strengthen them, and that you would heal them. We pray this, and we pray all our prayers in and through the name of the victorious Savior, Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. Friends, can I thank you again for joining us for our service of worship this Sunday, the 12th of July. Just want to share with you some words of blessing before we introduce our final hymn. So may the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you and remain with you this day and always. Amen. We're going to conclude our service again before we share the words of the grace together by singing this wonderful song. Because he lives. God sent his son, they called him Jesus. And listen to this last verse. And then one day I'll cross the river, I'll fight life's final war with pain, and then as death gives way to victory, I'll see the lights of glory and I'll know he lives. May the Lord bless you.
He lived and died. our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit, be with us all, evermore. Amen.